It was supposed to be satire. It's not supposed to be real. But the Babylon Bee has come to life. You see, at a racetrack in North Carolina, they dubbed the race a protest to defy the governor. I kid you not, Babylon Bee has come to life. Now, in order for you to truly understand this, I want to show you this satirical article from the Babylon Bee so you can get the joke. I'm sure most of you are familiar. The Babylon Bee is just a humorous satirical news website. And they wrote this story. Clever churchgoers avoid arrest by disguising themselves as rioters. You see, right now in New York City, you're allowed to protest. The DA's office said you will not be charged if you're a Black Lives Matter activist. However, churches are operating at 25% capacity. Yeah, sorry. You want to go worship for your religion? Not acceptable. You want to protest the acceptable ideology? All good. So the joke is kind of obvious. You can see it. They're in a church, but they're holding hammers and masks, broken bottles, and Molotov cocktails. And on the church wall, it says, no Trump, no KKK, no fascist USA. Welcome, please enjoy a coffee and join us. Here's what they wrote. Religious people in Southern California have found a bold, creative solution for in-person meetings in spite of the continuing lockdown. This past weekend, several area churches attended church services disguised as righteously indignant rioters. Bravo, bravo. We already have the righteous indignation thing down, said one church elder. Now we've simply added black balaclavas, hoodies, Guy Fawkes masks, and baseball bats. We found that when we do this, we can meet in large groups without much interference from the local authorities. It's been a delightful experience. Leaders from Spirit River in the city church in LA County are reporting a successful Sunday service after using this method. Churchgoers were given bricks and fake Molotov cocktails before they surrounded the church with menacing looks on their faces. Several deacons then smashed some church windows to make the riot look more realistic. Unfortunately, onlookers grew suspicious when the massive group of rioters broke out into a round of the smash hit worship song, Reckless Life Engulfment. Some of the attendees were forced to stage brawls in order to keep up appearances. According to sources, some churchgoers in the area are planning to continue wearing masks to church even after the lockdown has ended in order to hide their identities from Hollywood directors and producers. Okay, that's the article. It's funny, right? It was well written, but it was just supposed to be a joke. Well, this is the reality we deserve. In this story from WSOC TV 9, North Carolina auto race draws thousands after dubbing itself a protest. And there's the photo. Everybody gathering around, enjoying a nice, a rally car race of some sort or something. Over 2,000 people, maybe 2,500 people showed up to protest. Listen, man, if the government is going to allow protesters, then why wouldn't everyone just say they are? And that's what they're doing. The story says, a North Carolina speedway drew a crowd of more than 2,000 spectators in defiance of the state's coronavirus restrictions after declaring the race a protest. No, news outlet, you don't get to say that. You don't know. They say straight up they're protesting. Well, then what are you going to say? Why do you get to decide whether they're protesters or not? The governor's office had warned Ace Speedway in Elon that a crowd of more than 25 would violate the state's phase two coronavirus restrictions. But news outlets report that more than 2,000 people attended a race Saturday night. Ace Speedway workers performed temperature checks before people went inside the track. A sign from management outside the speedway said, "This event is held in peaceful protest of injustice and equality everywhere." The Alamance County Sheriff's Office said it is evaluating the events. What are you going to do about it? That's it? Now, listen, I think the reason they did this is because they had already been actively defying the government and the government had threatened them. Take a look at this story. In rural North Carolina, racing fans packed a speedway to defy governor in pursuit of freedom from May 24th. This is all part of the game of cat and mouse, escalating tensions between the ideologically driven okay laws and regular people and what they want. I think it's funny that you have this situation unfolding right now because it proves violence works. What do you think would happen if all of these right wingers went around with masks, rioting and looting? I think you'd see that they would eventually bend over backwards to support them. Unfortunately, for now, that's not what's, fortunately for now, conservatives aren't doing this. And it's unfortunate the left is doing this. And it's even worse that what we get in response to all of this, bending over straight for these protesters. Take a look at what happened last time. So here's the story from May 24th. They say, Cars kept pulling into the grassy lot surrounding the racetrack, their arrival creating a mist of dirt. I can't stand when journalists do this, man. I'm sorry. I'm skipping this. Don't write me a narrative. Just tell me what happened. They said they had come from all over the state, said Ernest Smokey Bear, who was working the front gate and checking people's coolers and bags that came through. They'd come from Charlotte and Goldsboro, from nearby Winston-Salem or Burlington, to watch the race cars speed around an oval 4/10 of a mile long. They'd come for the spectacle of it, for the familiar things they'd missed, the roar of the engines and the vibration on the ground as cars went by, the faint smell of gasoline. This is an awful article, mind you. They've been locked up, Yarbrough 64 said, of the hundreds of people surrounding him while he slowly walked ahead toward the ticket booth. They want to go somewhere, and this is the only place really legal to come around. All week, that had been a point of contention. The legality of this gathering, when North Carolina Governor Roy Cooper announced that the state would enter phase two of its gradual reopening amid the pandemic. The news came with limits. Cooper's executive order, for one, prohibited mass gatherings, and those had been defined as any gathering of more than 10 people indoors or more than 25 outdoors. With about 10 feet on either side of Yarbrough, there were more than 25 people. He didn't mind, nobody here minded, and whatever concerns anyone had were outweighed by the desire to be part of the mutual experience. Only a few people wore any kind of coverings over their face and bare. The man checking the bags at the gate was among them. It's been years since we had this many people. It's amazing. It's helping their business, dare I say. But there you go. You can see it right there. They knew it was illegal. The governor said you couldn't do it, and they went to do it anyway. Then what happened? I was recently talking to some locals in my area. Yeah, they're angry about it. They have nothing but derision for the governor of New Jersey. He's out, what, like protesting with people or whatever while he's telling other people to lock down? This was a very clever way to get around this, and it was only a matter of time before we saw it. Because everybody was saying the same thing, and it was bubbling up so much that the Babylon Bee made a joke article about it. We cannot have a government that says one ideology is okay and everything else isn't. We can't have a police department or a DA like in New York saying they won't prosecute people who break the law. Man, think about where we go from this. What do you think would happen if someone was like, I'm going to rob a bank in the name of restorative justice for Black Lives Matter? What are the cops going to do? Well, oh, in that regard, we're not going to charge them all that much. No, you can't function that way. You broke the law. You broke the law. It's already been bubbling up, though. We have terror laws. We have hate crime laws. And these things are ideological and rather dangerous. I'm surprised a lot of these things pass the Supreme Court, but they do. A lot of people have problems, say, hate crime laws, because look, if I punch you in the face, it doesn't really matter why I did it. That's the crime. But if you punch someone in the face and say something that's bigoted or racist or whatever, you get worse charges. I don't think that necessarily makes sense. People hate for a lot of reasons. People fight for a lot of reasons. And you hold people responsible based on a uniform law. We should all be equal under the law. We shouldn't have, like, how does it make sense, right? The First Amendment, it says that, you know, the Congress can't make a law affecting an establishment of speech or the abridgment thereof or whatever. But isn't that so if you add onto a law that if someone says something, you change what the violation is? So look, I'm not here to say we should or shouldn't have this stuff. I'm just pointing out the concerns there that we have already been seeing ideological application of the law. Now we've gotten it wholeheartedly. What do you think people are going to do come November? You know, the polls are saying Joe Biden is skyrocketing with a massive lead. I just can't believe it. If people are willing to go to these lengths to stage these big events, bring in thousands of people and claim to support the protest, what do you think that means? Let me break it down for you. Now, these people are doing it, obviously, tongue in cheek. A man was speaking, a black man, mind you, who was talking about freedom and defying Roy Cooper. Now, I hate to say it because I don't think race matters. It was just an American citizen standing up for his rights. Much respect to that good sir. But that's what things are being reduced to because of the intersectional identitarian left. But anyway, the point is, these are people who are telling you we're doing this. How many people do you think claimed they were protesting just to get outside for real? I'd be willing to bet a lot of people. Well, we know some people pretended to protest just to loot. I bet a lot of people were just like, I don't want to be inside anymore. I want to go outside and go for a walk. So they went out and just walked with the crowd. That probably made the groups look bigger. Think about what happens then when New York says they're not going to charge anybody. You know, every single New Yorker is going to be like, finally, I can go outside after months. And what are they going to do? They're going to walk right behind all the protesters because it protects them. That's why you can't have ideological application of the law. Now, here you go, man. They're all convinced. Their protest is huge, and they're going to win in a landslide, and the polls show and all that stuff. Fine, believe what you want. I don't believe it. I don't care. I just don't believe it. I have talked to my neighbors. I have talked to regular Americans. I have talked to family, and I am seeing something shocking. It's the exact same thing we saw in 2016. I was told by somebody who was in Europe at the time, during the most of the campaigning. They said all the news they saw said everyone hated Trump. Then they flew down to North Carolina and saw nothing but Trump signs everywhere and were shocked. People really supported the guy. So that's what I think will come happen in November. They can tell us all they want, but people are defying your lockdown orders. They're not going to vote for you come November. But I guess we can only wait and see. So I'll leave it there. Stick around. Next segment will be tomorrow at 10 a.m. and I will see you all then.